Good afternoon and welcome to the seventh meeting in 2022 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. We have one item on today's agenda, and that's to take evidence on the replacement of EU structural funds and levelling up from the Secretary of State for Levelling Up, Housing and Communities and Minister for Intergovernmental Relations, the Right Honourable Michael Gove MP. We have up to 90 minutes for this evidence session, and I therefore like to welcome the Secretary of State very warmly to the committee. Good afternoon, Mr. Gove. And I understand you do not wish to make any opening remarks, so we will move straight to questions, if that's okay with you.
Thank you very much for the invitation.
So I will, of course, open up, and then we will other colleagues will come in subsequently. So, UK ministers and the Conservative manifesto pledged to provide a fair and equal share of funding that fully replaces EU support, and in Scotland that would amount to around £183 million a year. But Westminster's Treasury Committee, which has, as you know, a Conservative chair in Mel Stride MP, published a report on the 27th of January which suggested that the UK Shared Prosperity Fund up to 24-25 will suffer a 40% reduction on the amount the UK received under EU structural funds from 2014 to 2020. So I'm just wondering if the Cabinet Secretary, if the Secretary of State, I realise you're not a Cabinet Secretary, can comment on those figures and what steps will be taken to ensure that manifesto pledge is honoured.
Well, thank you very much, Convener. And I think the first thing to stress is that the UK Shared Prosperity Fund ramps up over time as EU legacy funding diminishes over time. So, of course, it is the case that as part of the multi-annual financial framework which the EU had in place, funds were committed, and indeed funds are being spent on projects in Scotland and across the United Kingdom. As those funds wind down, so the UK Shared Prosperity Fund ramps up to fill that gap until eventually all EU funding, or legacy EU funding, I should say, of projects ends. But it's also the case that the Community Renewal Fund, the Shared Prosperity Fund, they're not the only ways in which the UK government provides additional funding above and beyond the block grant to replace the types of funding that the EU provided in order to ensure that we address productivity and other challenges across the UK. So the Levelling Up Fund as well is another means by which the UK government can provide support to local government and other actors in Scotland and elsewhere.
So basically you're suggesting that there's not going to be any gap in funding, would that be correct? And everything would, if it's
yes.
Corrected smoothly?
Our manifesto pledge was to ensure that for Scotland, Wales, Northern Ireland and Cornwall, that we maintain the level of funding that would have been the case if EU funding had continued. And indeed, I hope it will be the case that by the end of this Parliament, we can look at the Shared Prosperity Fund and also the Levelling Up Fund and other funds and see that that manifesto pledge has at the very least been met, if not exceeded.
Okay, I'm just wondering why then that the committee expressed such great concerns. They seem to be of the view that that wasn't going to be happening, that there was going to be a significant reduction in funding. That was backed by the Welsh Government in terms of their analysis also.
I think the inference I would draw is that it's a perfectly legitimate misunderstanding to conflate the UK Shared Prosperity Fund money with previous EU funding and to either ignore or overlook or put to one side the legacy of EU funding. Of course it diminishes, but it's still there, and also other funds like the Levelling Up Fund or the Community Ownership Fund as well. So if we're looking at money that is devoted to the types of projects which the EU used to fund, as I say, some of that money is still there from the EU and is declining. So the Shared Prosperity Fund will ramp up, but if you take UK SPF plus legacy EU funding together, then you get to, I believe, the manifesto commitment, and Levelling Up Fund and other funds take us, I hope, beyond that.
I think colleagues will want to explore that a wee bit further, but just to move on, the UK Government's Shared Prosperity Fund is intended to replace EU structural funds losses as a result of Brexit from April. However, the Scottish Government has yet to receive any detail of how much funding will be allocated to Scotland, and the reality is that the Scottish Government has not been consulted, nor have Scottish ministers had any role in investment proposals or decisions devolved to the Scottish Parliament. And new guidance on the Shared Prosperity Fund offers no evidence of respecting devolution or acknowledging the Scottish Government as an equal partner. Why?
Well, I would politely disagree. I think that the first thing to say is that the UK Shared Prosperity Fund and the other funds that the UK Government disburses are disbursed on the basis of objective criteria, which are there for assessment. And it's also the case that we work in partnership with the actors in local government and in the Scottish government. And it's explicitly the case that for the UK Shared Prosperity Fund, what we want to do is to make sure that there is intensive dialogue between ourselves and the Scottish government and its ministers over the basis on which the money should be distributed. In England, we've been clear that the money will go either to mayoral combined authorities or where there are no MCAs to the lower tier of local government, the borough or district councils. Now, obviously, in Scotland, there's a different local government structure. It seems to us sensible that that money should be distributed on the basis of city and local growth deal geographies. But we want to discuss with the Scottish Government how that's done. And we also believe that we want to ensure that money is allocated, as it will be in England, on the basis of a set of objective criteria that people can debate and judge and question. And what I'd like to do is to make sure that the Scottish Government is satisfied that the objective criteria that we set for the allocation of these funds meet with their approval.
But we're now at the end of February and the fund's going to set up and start from April, and the Scottish Government's still saying that there's been no consultation, no meaningful engagement. This is echoed by their devolved administrations. Why would they be saying that? And why, if there is going to be constructive engagement, is it being left to such a so late, you know, 12th hour, if you like?
Yes. No, I think that we need to look at the level of engagement that we've had in the context of other conversations that we've had with elected representatives who represent Scotland, those in local government and also MPs in Westminster as well. But we'll shortly be publishing our prospectus, which will outline how we believe that funding should be allocated. And at the moment, we're just making sure that we have adequate resources so that the manifesto commitment that you alluded to earlier is met in full.
You personally be speaking to Scottish ministers?
Absolutely.
Okay. Now, your visit has created a wee bit of a stir beyond Holyrood, Mr Gove, I have to say. And earlier this week, I was contacted by the European Marine Energy Centre based in Orkney. And it's the first and only accredited wave and tidal test centre for marine energy in the world. And over 16 years has contributed £306 million to the UK economy, supporting almost 200 jobs. Between 2016 and 2020, EMEC received more than £17.4 million from Europe, which was some 52% of its total funding, in fact. However, EMEC are deeply concerned because they say that your Levelling Up white paper, published on the 2nd of February, suggested that the UK Shared Prosperity Fund will be allocated entirely through local authorities, and that creates a real risk that EMEC and other unique organisations who are so crucial in terms of innovation and dealing with net zero miss out on crucial funding. So how will the Shared Prosperity Fund, or indeed any other mechanism, work to ensure that doesn't happen? Because you touched earlier on that there may be other funding streams, but if that's the case, then that's not being communicated to organisations such as this.
Well, I'm grateful to you for drawing my attention to that particular project and the admirable work that it does and the reliance that it's had on partnership funding. As I mentioned right at the beginning, as well as the Shared Prosperity Fund, and I'm sure that any allocation to Orkney Island Council would be prioritised by Orkney's locally elected representatives in a way that enhances the performance of precisely the initiative that you mentioned. But it's also the case that as well as that, there are funds, not just through the Levelling Up Fund, but through some of the other work that BASE, for example, does in ensuring that we can have a more diverse and secure base of energy supply. So again, I would be more than happy to talk directly to Orkney's elected representatives and to the leaders of that project in order to ensure that we can have continuity of funding through the different streams that the UK government is responsible for.
Okay, I hope they'll be reassured by that. I think, as you can understand, Joe, that what has made so many organisations nervous is that up until this meeting, they haven't had any communication. I understand that they have tried to communicate with your department and they've not been able to receive the kind of assurances that you've given me just now, which is obviously why they've contacted myself as a convener of this committee. So, moving on, Scotland's Council of Voluntary Organisations says it remains, and I quote, in the dark over how the UK Shared Prosperity Fund will reach a sector that's benefited greatly from European funding over the years. So how does your department intend to engage with Scotland's voluntary sector at both a strategic and delivery level to maximise the impact of the UK Shared Prosperity Fund for the voluntary sector?
My department is expanding its footprint in Scotland. We have a dedicated team of DLUHC officials whose job it is to work not just with local government but also with civil society in order to ensure that the funding that they need and they have a right to expect is delivered in a timely and in a as unbureaucratic a way as possible. Now, of course, it may well be the case that people from the voluntary sector have had access to support from ESF funding, which DWP, which of course has a UK-wide footprint, has been responsible for. I've been talking to my colleagues in DWP and indeed in the territorial offices about the relationships that they've had with organisations that have benefited from this funding. And one of the benefits of this committee hearing is that I can say through you, Convener, that elected representatives across Scotland who are either concerned about the future funding of worthwhile organisations or who see an opportunity in the funds that we have for support for new initiatives, I'd urge them to contact me and my department in order to make sure that we benefit from the intelligence on the ground that you and other elected representatives can bring.
Yes, again, I find your answer very positive, but the concern has been that up until this date, you know, with this UK Share Prosperity Fund about to launch in a matter of weeks, that these organisations still have not been kept up to date, and obviously they have to be able to fund projects, and they worry that there's going to be gaps and breaks in terms of that funding. So, can you assure us that that will not happen?
Well, again, I think, depending on the individual project, it might be the case with some of the voluntary sector projects that they're still in receipt of ESF funding, which will be tailing off, but we will do everything in our power to ensure that worthwhile projects that have been successful as a result of EU or other funds can continue to deliver for people in Scotland.
Okay, thank you. Now, a question that's been brought to me by a local authority chief executive is that, who's keen to know how you anticipate that levelling up will influence other local authority investment decisions out with the levelling up funds and UK Shared Prosperity Fund. Concerns have been expressed that unless levelling up becomes a cross-cutting policy, regional inequality will not, in fact, be addressed. So, for example, if two or three UK sites were deemed suitable for a specific type of investment, and I was given the example, but I'm not going to mention it just now unless you specifically ask me, what weighting would levelling up carry? So, for example, would a priority one area always be approved over priority two? Because in the last levelling up, the first levelling up disbursement funds, five out of the eight were in priority one areas, but then three weren't. So it's about how we ensure that the money goes where it's most needed.
Yes, there are several very, very good points there. The first is that we look at a set of criteria. So a priority one area is first in line, but we also need to assess the deliverability of particular projects. And one thing that I would say is that Aberdeen City Council came forward with a particular bid for the Levelling Up Fund. Aberdeen is not a priority one area, but the bid was prepared in an outstanding and effective way by Aberdeen civic leaders. So it deservedly and meritoriously secured that funding. But it's also the case in North Ayrshire, a priority one area, that we were able to provide transport funding, funding rather for a particular project, and quite right too. And one of the things that we want to do is to work with local government in Scotland and the Scottish Government to address regional inequalities. The whole levelling up white paper was designed to acknowledge fairly that there are inequalities between the different nations and regions of the United Kingdom and within them, and that we wanted to work with every willing partner in order to address precisely those inequalities. And of course, there are some areas where the Scottish Government rightly takes the lead because it has the devolved responsibility and it will have the knowledge of the delivery of public services. But it will also be the case that there will be a granular knowledge that people in local government and in civil society have. And then sometimes there will be a strategic element as well. So if we're thinking about transport and connectivity, then as Sir Peter Hendy's UK connectivity review underlined, sometimes you need to think about investment in those areas in a way that improves connectivity within Scotland and also between Scotland and the rest of the UK and indeed beyond. So the short answer is to the chief executive of the local authority that you mentioned, that we publish objective criteria. Being a priority one area means you're first in the queue, but it's not automatic that you will receive funding from the Levelling Up Fund. Though, as I say, with respect to the Shared Prosperity Fund, every part of Scotland will receive funding.
Okay, now, when Levelling Up Fund was effectively launched only a few months ago, in fact, less than a year ago, there was a very short window given to local authorities to prepare bids. And I know in my own area there was a big panic to get it all together. And there was a meeting with the chief executive, myself and the MP. The MP happens to be my wife, so there wasn't really any difficulties in terms of getting cooperation. And although the local authority has a different political tint to ourselves, we all agreed absolutely on the priority for our area, and we secured significant funding, for which we're very grateful. But a couple of things. First of all, if the MP had taken a completely different view from, say, myself and the local authority, there is a kind of suspicion within the kind of documents surrounding this process that the MPs have, in effect, a veto. So I want you to address that specifically. The second thing is that giving local authorities only 3-4 months to prepare bids makes it very difficult for some smaller authorities. And I know they can share resources across boundaries, but sometimes they might want to invest only in their own area. They might not have that in-house capacity, which puts them at a disadvantage, and smaller, poorer authorities obviously could struggle in such cases. So, you know, was the timescale that was given for the first allocation of Levelling Fund, I mean, did you really, in all sincerity, believe that was really adequate to ensure that the best possible bids were put together in that space of time? Because obviously it may be that in future you would want to rethink that, you'd want to give more time available. And subsequent to that, ironically, since the award was made last October, I spoke to Chief Executive just 4 months have elapsed, and he says, there's no money yet, I quote, there are a number of hoops to jump through, including a final business case. One of the issues with the funding is the amount of bureaucracy, which ironically this is the whole purpose of this is try and minimise it. So I realise that's a kind of fairly convoluted question.
I think those are very fair points. I think it was the case that it was done at a fair lick, yes. But to try and deal with all of the points in order. Firstly, no MPs or MSPs do not have a veto on a plan. It's a requirement, and it's an important one, I think, that MPs, MSPs are consulted, and their support is, of course, a powerful additional force to be reckoned with. But if there is a local authority that, for whatever reason, puts forward a good bid, and for whatever reason it doesn't secure the MP endorsement, the bid will be looked at in its own terms and on its own merits. But it was great that, in the case of North Ayrshire, that there was an alignment there. In terms of timing, yes, I think that the timing was not as extensive as it might have been, but we're now giving more time for the successive, two more tranches of funding to be allocated. I hope that more local authorities in Scotland will come forward. In terms of capacity funding, we gave capacity funding, I think, to every local authority in Scotland, but we recognise that there's a difference in resource between Glasgow, say, and North Ayrshire or East Lothian. And one of the things that we want to do, and I was talking to COSL about this earlier today, is to ensure that we can support local authorities to learn from one another, and that my department can also help local authorities to prepare their bid and to let them know whether or not something is likely to succeed by taking them through the criteria on which any allocation will be made. So, yes, we are learning from round one, and we can do better, but I do think that the £172 million that was allocated that was money that I think has been welcomed, and it's broadly in line with... So the Levelling Up Fund is going to be, you know, led and determined by the quality of the bids. It's broadly in line with bond allocations, as it were. So it's just over 9% of the total amount that was spent.
Okay. And in terms of the capacity funding that you mentioned, £125,000 for local authorities, I was advised that that did not, and I quote, go anywhere near the real cost of the bid and the work beyond that. And I know there's a second round of that, but would you not agree, though, that there are some concerns, particularly, again, in smaller local authorities that don't have the resources? You might have to buy in expertise, if you like, to be able to prepare bids, which, again, takes longer, etc. Mm. That could be a disadvantage, as indeed you know, if local authorities are saying, well, do you know what, you know, the 32 local authorities, in 2021 there were only 8 awards, is it really worth our while going down this track if we're not going to perhaps, you know, get anywhere near an award and we may be significantly out of pocket, which could impact on obviously our council taxpayers and service provisions? Yes.
Well, it's my ambition to make sure that those in local government have the resources that they need in order to make appropriate bids. That was one of the reasons why I was pleased to be able to talk to COSLA earlier today. And one of the advantages of this committee hearing is that I can say direct again to elected representatives, including those in local government in Scotland, that if they feel they need additional support from my department in order to prepare bids, we stand ready to provide that support. And I hope that if there are individual local authorities that are worried that they may be shooting into the air, as it were, then please do, without prejudice, get in touch with my department and we will work to make sure that we can give you a fair assessment of the likelihood of success.
Okay, well, thank you for that. I'm now going to open up the session to colleagues around the table. And the first colleague to ask questions will be Liz Smith, to be followed by Daniel Johnson.
Thank you. Secretary of State, you'll be very aware that this committee has recently published its report into the budget scrutiny for 22-23. And it was a unanimous report. And not only does it flag up quite a lot of concerns about the Scottish economy, but also about the budget process. And one of the conclusions that we made in that report was that there isn't sufficient transparency between both the UK government and the Scottish government about where the income streams are coming from and, just as importantly, about where they're being spent. And I have to say that that was some of the points that were given to us by people who were giving evidence to the committee during our scrutiny sessions. So can I just ask, in terms of the three new funds that we're discussing here, are you confident that both governments are absolutely clear about the amounts of money that are available and, just as importantly, in specific timescales, they know what these timescales are?
Yes, I think that there's not yet perfect information, but we hope very quickly that there will be all the information that this committee and other committees would need and outside bodies to scrutinise effectively whether or not the resource being allocated is fair, predictable and being spent effectively. So with respect to the Levelling Up Fund, as I said, it will be allocated according to objective criteria. It's a fund for which people, as we know, compete. But my aim is to ensure that in any given round of the Levelling Up Fund, that Scotland should get sums which are no less than would be allocated under Barnett, as it were. So overall, and then for the community, forgive me, for the Community Ownership Fund, it's a smaller fund, but again, that's bid-led. For the UK Shared Prosperity Fund, then what we want to do is to publish objective criteria, say this is the amount that we believe that Scotland is entitled to as a result of our manifesto commitment. And as the convener has done, people can judge whether or not those figures add up. And then we'll say, within that envelope, this is how we believe it should be allocated to local authority areas. But of course, at the moment, one of the things that I have to do, again, the convener brought out, is to talk to Scottish ministers to say, is this funding allocation, does it make sense to you, or is it defensible? Final thing is, I do think that scrutiny over the effectiveness of spend is important as well. And one of the things that I welcomed was work by the National Audit Office and the Public Accounts Committee in Westminster over how some of our other funds had been spent. They made the point that we hadn't necessarily done all of the valuations as rigorously as we should. And one of the ideas that we put forward in the Levelling Up White Paper is the idea of a UK policy laboratory so that we have a freestanding body independent of all governments which can help to scrutinise how effectively funds are being spent and can compare policies so that the Scottish Government can, if it's delivering money more effectively for particular ends, show up other administrations, but similarly so that there is an objective and independent assessment of Scottish Government spend so that parliamentarians here can also say, hold on a moment, surely we should be doing as well as, say, Wales are.
that's very helpful, Secretary of State, and it's your understanding that that would be done on an independent basis for all the spending right across the UK.
Exactly, that's our aim.
That's very helpful. Can I just refer to your very helpful letter to the committee on the 21st of February, when you speak about the engagement with the devolved nations about the three new funds. I just wonder if you can expand on that in relation to some of the concerns. In fact, the convener hinted about this in relation to some investment. There have been concerns expressed that the UK government was choosing to engage much more with local authorities and with stakeholders in local communities rather than with the Scottish government in the prime instance. And I just want to ask you about the process of this, because obviously the Scottish government develops a lot of its policy ambitions through what's called the National Performance Framework. And it's obviously vital that if this is all to work, there's got to be some articulation between the aims and objectives of the UK government and the aims and objectives of the Scottish government. So I just wonder if you could expand a little bit on how you see that engagement taking place, particularly in relation to the aims and objectives of the Scottish government.
Well, I think it's through in discussion with ministers that we can come to that shared understanding. I take one step back. When I was in my previous role in the Cabinet Office, we were charged with concluding, and then in my current role, we successfully concluded the Review of Intergovernmental Relations. That's meant that there are specific intergovernmental committees which meet to cover particular areas, so DEFRA, Secretary of State, and the Rural Affairs Cabinet Secretary in the Scottish Government will meet ideally monthly. We're setting one up which will cover precisely these areas, so it will mean that not just in advance of, but continuing after the establishment of the funding prospectus, I or my successors will be talking to our counterparts in the Scottish Government and the Welsh Government and the Northern Ireland Executive in order to make sure that policies are aligned. Now, it may be that from time to time that there will be disagreements, but those disagreements, I hope, will only come after there's been a process of trying properly to understand each other's point of view, the shared priorities and so on. And if the UK government is spending in a way that is, you know, foolish or wrong or counterproductive, then we can be fairly held to account, challenged, and face any democratic consequences. But what I want to do is to cooperate. And what I would say is that there's been a recent example of that in the way in which we approached the new green free ports that we are pledged to deliver together. I think the committee will be aware that there was an initial difference in approach between the UK government and the Scottish government, but thanks to the Scottish government's finance minister's approach, we've been able to reach an agreement. That's meant that there is additional UK government funding coming to Scotland above and beyond Barnet, and it also means that the Scottish government's strategic priorities when it comes to fair work and to net zero are respected. And obviously that's a model that we would want to replicate, because, you know, notwithstanding the fact that obviously the Scottish government and the UK government are composed of ministers from different political parties, nevertheless, wherever possible, we can find agreement, and that seems to me to be a good example and benchmark to set.
Could I just reference the fact that I think the understanding and cooperation of things like the Tay City deals, for example, were absolutely first class, because everybody was on the same page. The UK government, the Scottish government, and local authorities and local interest groups were very much on the same page about what the ambitions were for that particular project. And I think that was true of the other city deals too. I just wonder what the situation would be where there was a slight difference in the priorities that were being held up by the Scottish government through the National Performance Framework and the UK government, how that would be resolved to the satisfaction of both governments.
Ideally, through open dialogue, open regular dialogue, and honesty on our part where we might diverge. You know, one area where I want to try to find unity wherever possible, but one area where I think there might be a slight divergence, and it's at a sensitive issue, is over potentially future energy policy. And you know, my own view is that when, you know, there's a reason why BEIS exists as it does as a UK-wide department. Energy security, for sombre reasons of which we're aware, really matters. There are legitimate divergent views about how to achieve that. But I think that the emphasis on future investment in the oil and gas sector in the North Sea, you know, there is a difference there. And it may well be in the future, in fact, I know it will almost certainly be in the future the case, that the UK government will want to continue significant investment in the oil and gas sector, continued investment in the Northeast, in Orkney and in Shetland, in order to secure the future of the oil and gas sector as part of a transition. And there will, I'm sure there will be ministers in the Scottish Government who would argue that some of that investment might be better prioritised elsewhere. That will be a fair disagreement on which people can conclude. But I think in almost every other area we could reach a constructive approach and agreement.
Okay, thank you. One more question, if I may. This question is much more technical, and I apologise for that in one sense, but I think it's an important one. You said in your letter, and it's on the UK government website, setting out the methodology that's been used to measure the areas which you believe are most in need. And I think that's largely based on the indices that have been produced by the ONS.
Yes.
Now, when the Scottish Government makes an assessment of the areas that it thinks are most in need, it uses, obviously, the formal Scottish Fiscal Commission budget analysis and estimates, some of which are based on ONS input, but others are not. So I just wanted to ask you check that the UK government's assessment of the areas most in need, i.e. the methodology that you're using, is not using different data from what is being used about the Scottish economy, because obviously if there was different data, there could be different interpretations. And
yes.
Another conclusion from our budget report was the fact that Scottish economy sometimes suffers from having the Scottish Fiscal Commission and also the Office for Budget responsibility having different timescales. And are you confident that the methodology that's been used to decide which areas are most in need is an agreed formula for both sets of government?
I'm absolutely confident that our assessment is objective. If there is any difference in the sort of baseline set of assumptions and statistics, then I'm more than happy to come back to the committee in detail to investigate, or to explain rather, why we've made a particular judgment and where the Scottish Government might have a different view. But to my mind, the most important thing is the more we can have an agreed set or an agreed statistical base that's set across the United Kingdom, the better. I'm a great advocate for sharing data. I want to share as much data as possible about how we operate with this committee, with the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government. And if the Scottish Government has concerns about the basis on which we're making these calculations, we'll take an open book approach. And if some of our assumptions are out of kilter with the most up-to-date data, then we will update that. We've got nothing to hide in that regard. So, absolutely. And again, you know, when we talk about economic resilience, you know, one of the things is that more sparsely populated areas have less economic resilience. That's an assumption. Now, that's meant that, to take English examples, you find that there are places like North Yorkshire, which are sparsely populated and therefore have low economic resilience, but actually they're relatively well off if you look at the individual wealth of people, because they have a higher proportion of retirees and second homes and so on. So you could look at places in Scotland and say they're relatively sparsely populated. They're in Ballater, for example. But also, no one would say that was one of the areas that... So it has slightly lower economic resilience, but nobody would say it was an area of deprivation. So, of course, you know, there are objective figures, and then there's sometimes a way of saying, OK, well, we'll use a slightly different set of objective criteria, because actually this is a sharper way of getting to the people in need.
I think that's very helpful, Secretary of State, because I think it's absolutely crucial that the data that is being used to make these decisions is agreed, because, as I say, it could
Yes.
And this is, again, as I say, something that came up in our budget report. If it was different, that makes policy making all that more troublesome. Thank you very much, anyway.
Thank you, Liz.
Daniel, to be followed by Ross.
Thank you very much, Convener. Can I begin by welcoming the Secretary of State to the Committee? It's refreshing to have a UK Minister, and I'd encourage him to go back and encourage his colleagues to do likewise, because I think it's important for devolution's sake that that does happen. I want to focus on Levelling Up Fund and following on from some of the issues raised by Liz Smith and Kenny Gibson. But I want to begin by a contextual point. You know, if we look at productivity in Scotland, output per hour varies in Scotland by about 40%. It's at its highest per hour in Edinburgh at around £40 per hour, and its lowest in the Western Isles by £28 per hour. But even you don't even need to go as far as the Western Isles. If you look at Glasgow or Dundee, it's about £31. So there's huge disparities in relatively short spaces. So there's two points I was wanting to ask you about. First of all, that requires a thesis as to why that has occurred in the first place. And while I think there's a huge wealth of information here about looking at best value and impact, and indeed you've got your six forms of capital set out in the white paper, what I don't see is necessarily that thesis of why that has occurred. And I'm just wondering what work is going into that. And similarly, is there a danger by focusing on local authority areas that yes, you can invest within an area, but actually some of those points, if you think about Edinburgh versus Dundee and Glasgow, is actually about how those connections are made, and that it's important that these decisions are not made in isolation. So are those contextual points areas of work within this space?
Yes, I think you're spot on. And I think that quite a lot of the work in the Levelling Up White Paper and the analysis was commissioned and led by Andy Haldane, who, when he was Chief Economist at the Bank of England, was looking at this in detail. And it's something that my department has been looking at. Again, it's in the nature of my department that the information we have about the situation in England is richer, and so we can draw some conclusions from that. But I think that the conclusions that we've drawn about regional disparities in productivity in England apply in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland more or less in the same way. So to go specifically to your point, Edinburgh, it's not quite exact, but Edinburgh is to Scotland as London is to England. It's not just the case that it's the financial services and political capital, it is also the magnet for talent, and it benefits from what the economists call an agglomeration effect, or what's sometimes been called the Matthew effect, to them that hath shall be given. And it's in the nature of Edinburgh that you have a level of educational institutions, prestige employers, and also, though not every Edinburgh citizen would say so, transport links, which enable people to get quickly to a place of work. And it's also the case that Edinburgh has a rich cultural endowment as well, which makes it a very attractive place to live and work, ditto London. Other cities have suffered as a result of some of their major industries disappearing. So both Dundee and Glasgow, historically, if you look back at the manufacturing and engineering industries that were at the heart of their economic success when they were doing better comparatively, they've suffered as a result of that. And it's also the case that within Glasgow and Dundee, you also have some of the other problems that characterise or have characterised places like Sheffield and Bradford in the past. And so therefore, when you're thinking about how to improve productivity in those areas, you have to think, how can we, A, attract new industries? We can't direct investment in the way that we did in the past. The shadow of Ravenscraig and Linwood show that if you absolutely direct investment and you don't have everything else around it to sustain that, when chill economic winds blow, that you don't get the long-term sustainable investment and economy that you need. So Glasgow needs, it's got huge assets, but Glasgow needs more investment in higher and further education, more investment in science and technology. But we also need to look at some of the challenges that Glasgow faces in terms of crime, in terms of drug and alcohol abuse, and in terms of the resilience of communities that have had an incredibly tough time economically. So you need to look at a range of areas in order to ensure that you can get that productivity up. Final thing that I would say is that, as you quite rightly point out, distance is an issue as well. Shetland and the Orkney Isles have benefited, of course, from oil and gas and also from strong local leadership. The Western Isles, it's a very, very difficult situation, and connectivity is critical there. And then when I was visiting the Western Isles last year, one of the things that was reinforced is that the Scottish Government and the UK Government can work together on everything from ferries to digital connectivity to thinking about investment in hydrogen and in renewables in order to make the most of that community's potential. And that has to be part of the whole approach.
Thank you very much. With that in mind, I would like to sort of dig into the methodology a little bit more. My understanding in terms of the way these funds are allocated, first of all, is the indexation based on productivity, unemployment and qualification levels, all of which were given an equal weighting in that indexation. And then the assessment made on a scoring system using value for money, impact, and looking at the distribution across the three core themes of regeneration, transport and culture. So I guess I have two key questions. First of all, that initial indexation, we're talking about the complexity of the issues that you've just been discussing, and I would agree with the sort of the entangled nature. Those are quite narrow measures to be using to capture those things in terms of the first indexation. Likewise, weighting them on an equal basis. So my first question is, is this the methodology forever and for all time, or is there work looking at actually trying to embed some of these more complex issues, such as geography or other issues, into the assessment? And then finally, you've stated a number of times already that there's an objective decision-making process. My reading of it was that the final decision, once that scoring had taken place, was a ministerial one. Yes. And essentially a discretionary, and perhaps it needs to be, but that can't be entirely objective, can it? Is there going to be more work to, I think, open up that final round of decision makers? I think there is anxiety as to precisely what was used to make those final decisions once that scoring had taken place.
Totally. Those are all very, very fair points. On the first, yes, necessarily. When you're making an assessment about how to allocate funds, you don't have to, but if you want to try to make it objective, you've got to say, these are the scores that we assign to certain things, this is how we come to those scores, these are the factors that we're taking into account. I think way back when I was Education Secretary in the UK government, we were thinking, when we launched the People Premium, about how to give more money to students in disadvantaged backgrounds. And we used eligibility for free school meals. Now, it's not perfect, but it was a simple proxy measure which helped us to get the cash out of the door relatively quickly to those more or less in need. And that's what we've got here, a set of measures which we think are not perfect, but enable us to be judged fairly. Now, what I'm very keen to do, building on what you said and what Liz said, is have the maximum amount of analysis. And people say, well, this is more or less well-intentioned, but actually, the cash is going to the wrong places in the wrong way, and you need to refine your formula. I'm completely open to that. But I think that the basis on which the judgments have been set, I think, is reasonable for the moment, but it's not, to answer your question directly, set for all time. I'm perfectly open to considering how in the future we can refine the allocation of these funds completely. On the second point you raise about the element of ministerial discretion, yes, I think it always has to be there, because sometimes you can put, you can get all the data, you can put things in, but as I mentioned earlier, you start off by thinking, okay, productivity or economic resilience, threw it in, and then suddenly you find that Richmond in North Yorkshire or Ballater come out as the areas which, statistically, you would think deserve the money, and you think, that can't be right. We've got to revisit that. But one of the things also that's in our mind is we need to be able to show that this process has been objective, because all of these decisions are subject to judicial review, should someone want to challenge the basis, we have to be able to show how those decisions were made. I think it's a good thing, because it also means that we can get more value for money for the taxpayer, because there's no, if the aim is to improve productivity, and an additional pound somewhere where productivity is already high isn't going to get you that extra gain, then the taxpayer is losing out, as well as the community that should have got the money losing out. So the greater the transparency, the better.
So just on a very sort of practical level, for local authorities looking at the bids for the next round of funding.
Yes.
So on one level, you've got local authorities such as Angus or North Lanarkshire who made bids but were unsuccessful.
Yes.
Especially thinking about North Lanarkshire, they were category one. Will their success, or indeed whether or not there are other local authorities that didn't submit at all, will that be taken into consideration?
Yes.
And then. Right. And likewise, there were other bids such as, I believe in the convener's constituency, there is the Adir project, which is part of the North Ayrshire bid. That's a project looking at nuclear fusion. That has, first of all, energy security implications, but much wider externalities, potentially. Mm. That doesn't seem to be captured within the current methodology. Are those sorts of things potentially up for consideration in future funding rounds?
Yes.
Very helpful. So my final question is this. I think the common thread through my questions is that productivity, ensuring quality, these are big issues. They are complicated and they cost money. So the Levelling Up Fund is worth £800 million in Scotland over the coming years. But that's set against a Scottish economy, which is worth about £150 billion, give or take, a year. So what, at a system level, do you expect the outcomes to be from the Levelling Up Fund in financial or indeed other measures?
I think the Levelling Up Fund is only one of the ingredients at our disposal, because there are other ingredients as well, like the separate funding that's come from research and development, £100 million of which will go towards the three innovation accelerators, one of which, as I mentioned earlier, will be in Glasgow. And the shift in research and development spend is going to be part of it too, as will, I hope, the way in which we continue to support all sorts of increased competitiveness through export orientation of business. I think the judgment will have to be, how much do we succeed in the missions that we've put forward in the Levelling Up White Paper? And these missions are UK-wide. Now, it's perfectly possible that devolved administrations may take issue with the aspect of the missions. They may regard them as insufficiently ambitious. That's fair enough. But one of the things that we wanted to do was to say that the productivity gaps between the different parts of the United Kingdom would narrow, and that wage differentials between different parts of the United Kingdom would narrow. But the way in which we're measuring it in our missions, it should be the case that the productivity gap between, for example, London and Northern Ireland or London and Scotland should narrow. Within Scotland, when it comes to narrowing inequality and improving productivity, we don't have a metric that we've set ourselves. But if it was something that the Scottish Government wanted to do with us, we would very much welcome that.
Thank you very much. I'll leave my questions there.
Thank you. My understanding is that £800 million actually cover all three devolved nations combined, and so £450 million is for Scotland. Ross to be followed by Douglas.
Thanks, Convener. And I should apologise now, Secretary. I'll probably have to leave the meeting slightly before the formal close of the session. I'd like to stick with questions around the methodology. And first one's not Scotland specific. I'm just wondering if you could explain a little bit more the rationale for using Commons constituencies as a unit of measurement to cap the number of bids that can be made. Because it strikes me that it leaves the whole process more open to suspicion of accusations of it being used potentially as a system of patronage for MPs that the government of the day would like to keep on side for electoral reasons and marginal seats, etc. Could you explain a little bit about why, despite those concerns, which have been made before about other systems of funding, why you felt it was appropriate to use constituencies for the capping of the number of bids?
Yes, because the vital role that elected representatives play in being champions for their communities. And again, I know that the people have suggested that there might be an element of the pork barrel in it, but as some of the principal beneficiaries of some of these funds have been the convener of this committee and the deputy leader of the Labour Party, you know, I can see why people can be sceptical and cynical in politics, but then my argument would be, well, just look where the money has gone and look at the objective criteria that have been used. I mean, obviously, if the convener of this committee is re-elected with an even bigger majority in the next Scottish Parliament elections, that will be for many reasons. But if it's as a result of him benefiting from UK government funding, then that is something I will have to take on the chin.
I'm sure you'll have your endorsement on the next leaflet going out in a few months' time, I'm sure. Moving then to some Scotland-specific concerns around the methodology, which I'm sure you're probably already aware of, but without trying to put words into your mouth, I was taking your initial response to the convener's line of questioning as essentially saying that you're operating the equivalent of a no-detriment policy for the amount of funding that Scotland's to receive compared to what it would have from if we were still within the European Union. Bringing that down to a more local or regional or local level, there are concerns being raised, particularly by Highland Council, that as the Highlands and Islands were considered a transition region under European arrangements, they were eligible for more funding, certainly disproportionate to their population share. But the Highlands weren't a priority for the CRF and were ranked lowest on the scale for the Levelling Up Fund. Could you perhaps defend the place that we've got to where it appears, certainly our Highland and Island local authorities feel that they are now being put at a significant disadvantage compared to if we were still within the European Union?
Yes, I mean, you're right that if you look at the priority 1, 2, and 3 areas, that there are places that one would automatically assume to be priority 1 areas like Glasgow and North Ayrshire. But then I think some people might raise an eyebrow and thinking, Highland, a priority 3 area? I think that is a fair point. And that's why, in response to other questions, I think we need to keep these judgments under review. With respect to the Highlands and Islands, it was the case that one of the eight successful Levelling Up Fund bids was a successful bid from Highland, from Inverness. The second thing also is that I'm very conscious of the fact that for a host of reasons, we need to do more to support the Highland and Island economy. That's why I deliberately chose to visit the Western Isles last summer to talk to councillors and to business people there. And we're thinking hard in my department about how the specific needs of the Highlands and Islands, for the reasons that you mentioned, can be addressed. So, you know, again, going back to some of my answers to Daniel's questions, there are a range of tools. So we have the UK Shared Prosperity Fund, we have the Levelling Up Fund, but there are other things that we can do in partnership with those local authorities and with the Scottish Government to deal with those unique situations. So, again, one of the things that I would like to do is use UK Government funding to directly provide improved ferry services for people from the Western Isles, Orkney and Shetland. Now, transport is a devolved responsibility. I respect that. But my door is open to working with the Scottish Government in order to do just that. And one of the reasons why we've set up a UK-wide islands forum is that there are issues, even though the Isle of Wight is a very different place from Anglesey, which is a very different place from Lewis, which is a very different place from the Orkney Islands, there are common issues that they all have that we believe we should bring together and work on.
Just on that point around transport, and particularly relevant to the Western Isles Ferry Services that you mentioned, they submitted some evidence to us raising their concerns about the differences between methodology for Scotland and England, and transport connectivity being a much more straightforward part of the process in England, so there's 25% waiting for it. The argument they make, which I'm sure everyone around this table would agree with, is transport connectivity means lifeline services for these kind of communities in a way that it doesn't for many other communities across the UK. Transport is important to everyone, but for some folk, lifeline barely begins to scratch the surface of how important it is. Could you explain a little bit why there is that significant difference in the methodology between Scotland and England, and respond to the concerns that have been raised with us, that essentially this puts some of the least connected communities at a disadvantage because their lack of connectivity is not being taken into account in the methodology, whereas if they were in England, it would be.
That's entirely fair, and I think one of the things that we do need to address are precisely those connectivity questions that you raise. And one of the reasons for publishing objective criteria to begin with is so that precisely those concerns can be addressed. And again, it goes back to the point I made in response to Daniel and to Liz, that you can never, or you can very rarely have, a perfect set of objective criteria that capture every level of need, but you can put forward a proposition, you can put forward a set of rules, say that's the basis on which we're allocating money, and then people say, hold on a moment, as a result of that, we're losing out, and unfairly so. That gives governments an opportunity to say, okay, right, yes, actually you do have a point. There may be additional funding, or changes to methodology, or both, which can help address that concern. But part of the purpose of the original Union Connectivity Review that the Prime Minister commissioned from Sir Peter Hendy was to help to inform some of those decisions better. And for all the reasons that you rightly raise, I am concerned about the fragility in particular of the Western Isles economy and the need therefore to ensure that it has not just the ferry but also the other transport connections it deserves.
Drill down on that though then. Can you, I understand entirely, I think it's right that there are differences in methodology between the different nations to recognise different local contexts, but can you explain why the transport connectivity methodology is different given the particularly acute transport connectivity issues that we have in some areas of Scotland?
I think it's a consequence of the policy advice that we will have received from officials about what the best and most equitable way would be of allocating resource. As I mentioned earlier, I think that we can look at a range of different factors, and we can be conscious, as you quite rightly point out, that in considering some of the productivity challenges that that Scotland has faced, we may not have given all the weight that we should to connectivity, but that's because there are other productivity challenges that Scotland faces, or that Wales or Northern Ireland faces, that we put front and centre. But the whole process of policy evolution and input from colleagues like yourself is designed to address that.
And just one final brief question, going back to this point of no detriment overall to Scotland from funding, would you be willing to confirm now an extension of that to the Highlands and Islands specifically, that your intention is to ensure that the region as a whole is no worse off in terms of the funding through these arrangements than it would have been if we were still within the European Union?
I want the Highlands and Islands to be better funded.
Thank you. I look forward to seeing that.
MSP, that'd be a great victory for the boss. Okay, Douglas, to be followed by Michelle.
Thanks, Convener. Secretary of State, you mentioned earlier that meetings are still ongoing with the devolved Scottish Government. As a local authority, former leader, one of the things I liked about the Levelling Up Fund is that we could go direct to the UK Government. For me, that was true devolution. So will that be up for negotiation with the Scottish Government, or is that something that is always going to be reserved to the UK Government?
The Levelling Up Fund will always be reserved to the UK Government. The ultimate decision will be the UK Government's. Now, we want, wherever possible, to work with the Scottish Government, but ultimately these are UK-wide funds. I should say that my colleague Neil O'Brien is talking to Minister Richard Lochhead tomorrow about the UK Shared Prosperity Fund. We always want to reach agreement, but ultimately it's a reserve matter.
Because I guess there is always, it was mentioned earlier, in a conflict. Local authorities have their own priorities, the local outcome improvement plan. The Scottish Government, they have their own priorities, the national performance framework. So it will always be the local outcome improvement plan that will determine if a bid is successful, and not really the devolved government's performance framework. Would that be correct?
Yes. Again, we will take it into account. We want to reach agreement wherever possible. As you will know better than anyone, the bid that was put forward by Aberdeen City for the Levelling Up Fund was the fruit of a huge amount of work that was done by the local council with the local business community, taking into account the views of everyone who cares about the city. With a bid like that, then we had to say yes. And even if the Scottish Government had said, hold on, then, that's not our priority, it would seem to me wrong that, for the reasons that you outline, wrong that Aberdeen's civic leaders aren't rewarded for their efforts and their hard work and their leadership. And the whole thing, I think, about devolution is that you work with every tier of government. And when I was talking to COSLA earlier, I was able to quote from Lord Smith of Kelvin, Smith Commission report. That commission report, as well as giving additional powers to the Scottish Parliament, also said that he hoped that Holyrood would give additional powers to local government in Scotland. Now, it is a devolved matter. That is for the Scottish Government to decide. But I think that's right. One of the things we're trying to do in England at the moment is to give more power to local government in England. I think it would be great to see local government in Scotland assume more powers because, as your own example shows, Aberdeen has been enhanced by great civic leaders.
Oh, thank you. And
I was thinking of Jenny Lane.
I really do look forward to seeing that that whole project come into life. I think it will completely change the city centre of Aberdeen. One of the other groups we have in Aberdeen and the North East region is, of course, the regional economic partnership between the City Council, Shire Council, but also Opportunity North East. And I guess from the Levelling Up funds, there is scope for them to be involved also. Yes. Because I'm thinking, a lot of the thing that they do is trying to get private money as well to match some of the public money that we have. So I guess there's scope for Ian Wood to be involved also when we're putting new bids together for future funding.
Completely. Again last year, when I was meeting with Sirian and Kate Forbes at an Opportunity North East initiative in Forrester Hill, a life science and healthcare initiative, one of the things that Cabinet Secretary Forbes was clear about and that Ian Wood was clear about is working together across geographies in the interests of the North East is critically important. And I mentioned briefly earlier our view about the future of the oil and gas sector. Aberdeen in the North East is still relatively prosperous compared to other parts of the of Scotland and the United Kingdom. But prosperity can diminish as well as grow. It's absolutely vital that we think of the North East, Aberdeen, Aberdeenshire and beyond, when we're thinking about the future of energy. Absolutely vital that we secure additional investment in the oil and gas sector as part of a fair transition. And we can only do that by using the UK government's influence and funding alongside strong local leaders and, I hope, in partnership with the Scottish government. But it's, for the reasons that we both know, safeguarding jobs and prosperity in the North East depends on investment in the oil and gas sector. And also, for all of the sombre reasons of which we're aware, energy security in the long term depends on maintaining oil and gas as part of the energy mix in the future. And that's something that we're committed to doing. And it's a key part of uniting and levelling up.
I absolutely agree. While we've still got demand for oil and gas in this country, it's best that we still produce it ourselves.
Exactly.
Especially, what we're seeing happening in Ukraine, in terms of energy, what that might mean to energy security, it's absolutely vital. One last question was, what more can the UK government do to so local government doesn't feel disenfranchised by the Scottish government?
Well, I think that it's by having a three-cornered conversation. So I was delighted to be invited by COSLA to speak to their conference earlier today. I outlined the approach the UK government's taking in England and also the partnership that we want to have. And I think that the Scottish government will be able sometimes to highlight some of the funding and other challenges that parts of Scotland face, quite right too. But we can also stress that there are things that the UK government does which are part of the reserved space, which will mean that we will be in conversations with people in local government and in business, and we can talk to the Scottish Government about that. So it is quite right that Kwasi Kwarteng or Greg Hands are in Aberdeen talking about the future of energy. As a result of those conversations, they can discuss with Kate Forbes or the First Minister everything from land use planning to investment in hydrogen to how we ensure that the oil and gas sector play a part in transition, and quite right too. That is people working together, respecting their own responsibilities, but recognising that there are particular needs for that level of investment. And I think that that's the way to go.
Thank you, Secretary of State. Thanks, Camino.
Okay, thank you. Michelle, to follow by John.
Good afternoon, Secretary of State. We've talked around this quite a lot in terms of the specific methodology used for the Levelling Up Fund, and you mention objective criteria and so on. And yet, despite that, we've ended up in a position where the failure, as you yourself said, to integrate connectivity data from Scotland has contributed to Orkney, Shetland and the Highlands being placed in the category least likely to benefit from the fund, alongside areas such as the City of London. How confident are you now in the methodology that was adopted?
Well, I think, again, the methodology helps us to make that decision, but it's also the case that, as I pointed out, on the one hand, about two-thirds of the funding allocated was allocated to priority one areas, where the level of deprivation is greatest. But it's also the case that Highland benefited. It's also the case that we're working specifically with Island authorities through the Islands Forum in order to ensure that they can have the best possible bids. So the basis on which the funding is allocated, as Daniel pointed out earlier, is according to a set of criteria, and the priority areas are identified according to a particular methodology which can be critiqued. But while you can be front of the queue as a result of being in priority one, it doesn't mean that priority two or priority three areas lose out, because, as I say, one priority two and two priority three areas receive funding from the Levelling Up Fund.
Well, thank you for that, but I have to admit I'm no clearer. Mm. We have ended up in the position, and I'll say it again, that Orkney, Shetland and Highland were placed in the category least likely to benefit from the fund alongside the City of London. How on earth did that happen? And could I gently suggest that had you consulted with the Scottish Government, they might have been able to inform you that that was a ridiculous outcome. So I am asking you, with the benefit of hindsight, would you like to reflect on the methodology used that arrived at that position?
It's only one part of the methodology, and of course...
Is it the right part? Is it a good outcome when that happened?
Well, the outcome was £20 million going to Highland and three projects in and around Inverness being funded. And it's also the case that that was simply the first of three rounds of funding. So I think the conclusion about whether or not funding has been distributed equitably will come at the end of the process. It's a bit like saying that before you know how a play is going to turn out, on the basis of which character appears first, you know who the hero or the heroine is going to be. We'll have to wait until the curtain falls at the end of the allocation of all of these three rounds. And if, as I say, we find out that priority one, two and three have been important but not completely determinant factors, then I hope that we can both consider what's worked and what hasn't.
Well, I think that's a rather heroic attempt to talk away that. But let's carry on just now. I wanted to ask you, what has your engagement been with Audit Scotland? We've bounced around here around governance, which is, of course, very important. And you yourself have said scrutiny over effective spend. So what agreements have you made with Audit Scotland and what are in the public domain that you can share today as to how you will be accountable to them for the spend you make in Scotland?
I'm accountable to the UK Parliament, to Audit Scotland, to anybody that you would like to suggest on how this spending is designed, allocated, and what the evaluation framework is. The
only thing... agreement have you made with Audit Scotland in that respect?
I'm waiting for Audit Scotland to make any suggestion to me about what they would like to do, the information they'd like to have, the evaluation that they would like to make. The same would apply to any independent body or academic institution. We're creating in the Levelling Up White Paper for the first time a UK policy lab which will allow policy outcomes across Scotland, Wales, Northern Ireland and England to be compared. One of the difficulties that we face is that We have, for example, a richer data set about educational outcomes in England than we do in other parts of the United Kingdom. And that means that comparisons between Scotland and England in educational and skills terms are simply more difficult. And the decision by the Scottish Government, understandable, devolved decision, to withdraw even from some international educational assessments means that Scottish citizens are in a data poorer position. Now, we want to change that, and I would welcome any partner in Scotland or elsewhere that wants to ensure that we can have effective and comparable data about public sector performance and about governmental performance. But I can't compel Audit Scotland or any other independent body to do anything other than its leadership wishes.
Well, given that Scotland has a different education system, as you well know, I wouldn't be entirely confident in terms of methodology, given what we've seen with transport connectivity. I wanted to just...
No, but that is precisely the point. The thing is that, of course, Scotland has a different education system, but what one of the things is that what we can't know reliably is the extent to which Curriculum for Excellence has been working or not, because we have much more data, objective data, about what happens in schools in England than we do in Scotland. And we also have, because the English education system competes and participates in more international tests and measures of performance than Scotland, we don't even have that sort of objective basis on which to judge. Now, I'd love it, for all sorts of reasons, if we were in a position to identify what's working in Scotland's education system, both so that those bits of the Scottish education system that are doing less well can emulate the very best, and that those bits of the English education system that are doing less well can learn from high-performing schools and local authorities in Scotland. But at the moment, we just can't do that because we don't have the data.
I sense, Mr. Grove, this is breaking news, that not only do you want to take some powers away from the Scottish Parliament in some of the areas that previously resided with the EU, now there are some areas within education that are totally and utterly devolved. But I want to...
No, I don't want to take any power away. I just want people to be able to make more meaningful comparisons, because, as you quite rightly point out, we all have a responsibility to ensure that some of the judgments that we've made about policy are held to account and are open and transparent. And my argument is, bring it on. Anyone who wants to assess or to analyse the effectiveness of UK government spend, whatever the means is, absolutely delighted. But in assessing the effectiveness of UK government spend, we also need to be able to look at objective data about the effectiveness of Scottish government spending. And we have less objective data about that. Now, it's not for me to determine the policy, but I do think that voters everywhere will then be in a position to make a judgment about the relative merits of individual policies in the jurisdictions that they inhabit and of the governments for which they vote.
Only if you can compare apples with apples, and that's precisely my point about methodology, which was called so wrong in terms of transport connectivity. And I make the point again, you could have spoken to the Scottish Government in the first place and they would have pointed it out. But I do want to quote from my own local council, which was Falkirk, in terms of the delays. They note that the delays, there was increasing concern over damage to reputations of the applicants, the council and the UK government. Such was the lack of engagement by the UK government. Now, this is a local council who, you will probably be aware, did win some money, although they did comment that they felt it was cherry-picking a small number of high-profile projects. So what are you going to do going forward specifically to engage effectively, first of all, with the Scottish government and primarily with the Scottish government here today in the Scottish Parliament? What are you going to do differently?
Well, I mentioned earlier that we concluded the Intergovernmental Relations Review. That means that all UK government ministers in the departments where they have particular responsibilities will be meeting with their counterparts in the Scottish Government, the Welsh Government and the Northern Ireland Executive on a regular basis.
At what point? After it's a done deal?
Oh, no. They on a regular rhythm. Now, it obviously depends on what each of those jurisdictions want. But in the first instance, I speak nearly weekly, sometimes more often than that, to the First Ministers of Scotland and Wales, and when they were in post, to the First Ministers and the Deputy First Ministers of Northern Ireland. Most of the conversations recently, for understandable reasons, have been about COVID, but in those conversations, any issue can be raised. In advance of the publication of the Levelling Up White Paper, I held a specific call again with all of the First Ministers to outline the additional investment that we were making. It will also be the case that I'll be meeting whoever is nominated from the Scottish Government on a monthly basis to discuss specific housing and local government issues. It's also the case that I've spoken to COSLA and addressed their conference today. I have visited and will visit any local authority in Scotland that would like me to visit, whether that's Glasgow, Falkirk, Edinburgh, or has been in the case in the past, Aberdeen, Highlands, Western Isles, and so on, in order to ensure that we work for them. My department has increased the number of UK government civil servants working in Scotland in order to ensure that. The more the UK government can work with every elected representative in Scotland, including in Falkirk, the happier I will be.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
John.
Thanks very much, convener. And last but we'll decide if others decide if it's leased or not. If I could kind of return to the, you know, is the money going to the neediest areas kind of question, which I realise other colleagues have touched on already. I mean, in your letter back to us, which was helpful, thank you, you say 60% of the bids have gone to Category 1 in Scotland. You know, I suppose to some extent I find that a little bit surprising. If we're really levelling up, should it not be 100%? And kind of added to that, we have a cross-party group here which is on industrial communities, which tends to focus on former coal fields and other industrial areas. And they work closely with the Industrial Communities Alliance. So they came out, they did a kind of analysis of the 105 successful bids. And they were making the point that of the 94 successful bids in England, Scotland and Wales, only 42 are in the poorest third of sub-regions, going by GVA per head. And 14 of the successful bids are in sub-regions where GVA per head is above the UK average, including 6 in London. So based on that, I mean, some people might think, you know, the money's not really going to just the poorest areas.
I think, again, in a way, there's your question is part of a debate with Ross and Michelle as well, in that the priority one areas were identified in a particular way, and it's perfectly fair to say that the process by which we arrived at those priority one areas could be improved. The thrust of your question entirely fairly is if we're trying to deal with low productivity and with poverty and inequality, surely it should only be priority one areas. But Michelle and Ross's view would be, well, actually, priority one areas miss out on some of the subtleties of sets of challenges that some communities face. And I think that it's also the case that even within some of the wealthiest regions or cities of the United Kingdom, there is inequality as well. So I think, you know, any representative of Edinburgh or Glasgow would say, you know, alongside the wealth of Morningside is the poverty of Wester Hills. Alongside the wealth of the West End of Glasgow is the reality of life in Drumchapel. And so you can have geographies that fall into Category 2 or Category 3, and within it you can have areas that really need help. Now, your broader point about coalfield communities is a very fair one. And one of the things that I'm very conscious of is the legacy of industrial scarring in parts of central Scotland that we need to take account of. And that is a factor. But those aren't the only communities in Scotland where there are economic challenges.
I mean, I take your point that there are poorer people in communities, and I've been in Aberdeen and seen poorer areas in Aberdeen, for example. But, I mean, it would also be said that generally a poorer person in a richer area will do better than a poorer person in a poorer area. I don't know if you'd accept that.
Overall, yes, but there will always be exceptions to rules, but yes, fair point.
Okay. You know, specifically, I take your point too. I think it was an answer to Michelle Thompson that the first kind of bid that appears isn't necessarily typical of what's going to come thereafter. I mean, the first one in Glasgow that I'm aware of is £13 million for the Pollock Stables.
Yes.
Now, I'm all for horses and I'm all for a bit of culture.
Yes.
But, you know, some people would feel that was not the top priority if we're trying to get the poorest communities in Glasgow levelled up. And, I mean, presumably we could have built 130 houses for that. So, I mean, again, what's your answer to that? That sent out a bit of a strange signal, I would have thought.
Well, the two things. One, this was a bid that came from Glasgow City Council itself. So, you know, great city, great council leader. But if you as an elected representative in Glasgow think that the City Council should be taking a slightly different approach towards its bids, that's fair enough, and we will assess them. But the other thing I would say is that poorer parts of great cities can also benefit from investments which make the city overall a magnet for additional investment too. So it's not the case. We can legitimately argue whether or not investment might have been better targeted in the East End rather than the south side of Glasgow. But it's also the case that investment that makes Glasgow overall more successful should benefit all of its citizens.
Yeah, I mean, I do take that point. I'm very much in favour of the Borough Collection, for example, as being upgraded, as you probably know as well. But, I mean, by that argument, you could almost say, well, any expenditure anywhere is going to have a bit of a boost and it needs to be kind of targeted to some extent. If I could go back to your letter, one of the questions was about what happens if, during the bid process or actually spending the money, something untoward happens. And you answered that to some extent, but specifically on inflation. I mean, I think inflation is a little bit higher and looks likely to be a little bit more persistent than most of us had expected. You know, what does happen if a bid comes in? Can there be any extra money if inflation takes off?
Well, I wouldn't want to at this stage say that I wouldn't want to have people think that they can come in, bid at some X, and then return and say, well, you know, costs have risen, can I have an extra amount? But by definition, if it's a good bid, well-funded, good business case, things proceed, and then right at the very end, there's a need for some additional finance just in order to make sure that things can be delivered, then we'll always look sympathetically. But again, it should be the case, as bids come forward, and they're fairly assessed, that a business case will take account of potential inflationary or other pressures. Now, all sorts of things can happen. The unexpected can hit economies and can particularly hit individual communities. So I wouldn't want to be insensitive, but I think it's important that there's a degree of budget discipline when bids are put forward as well.
No, I mean, I'm all for budget discipline. And I mean, your letter said help troubleshoot delivery issues, which I did feel was a little bit vague. But I mean, I'm encouraged by what you've just said, which is look sympathetically, which I think is a little bit stronger and probably will reassure some people a bit more. I think to change it to a bit different subject, you've got a very long title there, which I was reading, but on the intergovernmental relations bit, the whole budget process, Liz Smith touched on budget earlier on, about transparency and things like that, but I was thinking about the timing of it. And clearly the last few years have been strange years, so we can leave them aside in a sense. But even before that, you know, the ideal to me is that, first of all, the UK sets its budget, and then Scotland, Wales, Northern Ireland set their budgets, and then local government sets its budget, and that would seem to be the kind of logical process. But we haven't really been there recently, and I don't know if that falls within your remit at all. I'm sure the Chancellor and people are a part of that too. But do you think in the longer run we can get to that kind of place where, you know, first the UK sets its budget, then the devolved parliaments, and then local government?
Ideally, but one of the things I've found is that finance ministers in any government tend to make decisions and the rest of us find out about them afterwards.
Right, well, that's a fair answer. That's actually quite a good answer, I think. Okay, I think I'll leave it at that. Thanks, convener. Okay.
Thanks very much. That's exhausted questions of the committee. I've just got a few more to wind up, but not too many, and I will be giving you the final word, Secretary of State. It was to follow on really from what John asked with regard to inflation, because the prospectus for the Levelling Up Fund published in March 2021 explained that, and I quote, once funding awards are decided, relevant local institutions are responsible for their delivery. Further contributions from the fund will not be provided to meet cost overruns after funding has been agreed. Now, obviously that was in March last year. I'm just wondering if there's an update in that position, because you seem to hint in your answer that there's a possibility of flexibility, because we're now at a situation whereby we could be facing inflation at 7%, and I'm concerned about sustainability. What we don't want is projects to be 80, 90% of the way completed, and then end up with a white elephant because there isn't the money available to finish it, and I don't think that would help either the UK government, you know, local authorities, Scottish government or whoever, if that was to be the case. So, are you telling us now that position has softened? You did talk about fiscal discipline, which I think we all accept is important. But are you saying that is no longer on the kind of tablets of stone it appears to have been in March last year? So, because the inflationary situation, I appreciate, would not have been envisaged possibly a year ago. You know, if it's a 2% inflation, well, OK, you'll just have to manage that. But when we're getting 7%, and who knows what the impact of the latest today's conflict will be on that going forward, How is this going to be managed?
Well, I think going back to my point about finance ministers, I don't think the Chancellor of the Exchequer would thank me for saying that people can automatically add a 5% or a 7% to the cost of the project like that. And as you quite rightly point out, we all would all expect a degree of budget discipline. But I also think your point about a project being close to completion and then not wanting to spoil the ship for a ha'porth of tar, I do take that point. But the position as outlined is the position, but of course ministers always exercise discretion and flexibility in order to make sure that successful projects can be delivered.
Well, I think that's an important caveat. Yeah, I think that's very important, because what you're saying is that effectively you look at an individual project by project basis to see whether or not an increase is justified.
Yes, exactly. And you know, the whole point is that we want to work closely with local government and delivery partners in order to make sure that projects are successful.
Okay. Now, from today's discussions, you've touched on things such as education, ferries and local government, all of which are devolved. In fact, education, along with the legal system, as you'll know, was part of the active union preserving Scotland's unique education system. And yet, we know that, for example, the £559 million adult numeracy fund will be managed by the Department of Education across the United Kingdom. I mean, is that a first since 1707? Because I'm not really, I mean, maybe I'm just not aware of it, but my understanding was that such matters would really, you might allocate funding to Scotland, but it would really be a decision to be made here in Scotland.
Yes, the decisions would be made in Scotland about how that funding would be allocated. But without wanting to quibble with your essential point, manifestly it's been the case that both before devolution and since 1707, Scotland had its own distinctive education system. But it's also been the case that Scotland's universities, which of course four of them predate the Act of Union, Scotland's universities also benefit from UK government funding as well.
The one is managed, actually, not the funding allocation, because it's about the funding being managed by the UK government, not the funding being allocated.
I think there are two things there. One is that some of what we'll be doing in adult numeracy, and indeed in education overall, is providing digital resources for people across the United Kingdom. Mm-hmm. But anyone can turn them on and off, as it were, but the money, the adult education funding, the adult numeracy funding, we'll go to, we'll talk to the Scottish Government about how it's going to be distributed, but ultimately it will be for the Scottish Government to decide.
Okay, and just moving on to one other subject, which again we've kind of touched on a wee bit, which is that the
you know, the kind of Levelling Up funding white paper explains that UK government is to embark on, and I quote, a process of sustained and systemic engagement and consultation with a wide range of stakeholders, including devolved administration. The white paper will set out further detail a number of these policy commitments in future publications. In addition, we will introduce legislation to Parliament to underpin and statute the changes fundamental to Levelling Up alongside wider planning measures. I appreciate that. Now, in terms of that, and in terms of Audit Scotland, which has been touched on, will there be a formal role within that legislation for Audit Scotland in order to look at how funds are being effectively spent in Scotland?
I'm completely open to that, yes.
Right. Okay, well, thank you very much for that. I think that's very positive, and that really, we're up to 30 seconds from our 90 minutes. So what I would like to do, as I've just said a minute or two earlier, is to allow yourself, as Secretary of State, to make any further points you wish to make before we conclude this meeting.
Well, I just want to say thank you very much, Convener, to you and to all of the members of the committee. And as was indicated earlier, the more that UK government ministers can appear in the Scottish Parliament to answer your questions, the more I think that is a demonstration of how devolution can and should work. I will, on behalf of this committee, stress to all of my colleagues in the UK government that a warm welcome and tough questions await them when they come to Holyrood, but it's both a duty and a pleasure to come here.
We're all pussycats really up here, you know. No, I just want to thank you formally for coming along in person, which I think is really important to this committee.
Yes.
We really appreciate people taking the effort. I know you could have come, you could have spoken to us virtually, which would have not had the same impact, I believe. We would not have been able to scrutinise quite as effectively. So thank you for that. We do have an important role to play in scrutiny at this committee, and we certainly look forward to working with you and your colleagues in the months and years ahead. So thank you very much.
Thank
and
you.
On that note, I wish to close this meeting. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.